Hello and welcome to another video from the only channel you need to not only survive the current apocalypse but actually enjoy it. And today's video is going to be a book review of about 100 different books, all claiming to be the Bible. Hopefully there will be several videos in this series, each covering a different aspect of why our English translations are so different from one another. If you were raised in a religious household, it is very likely that you have spent your entire life being told that a certain version of the Bible was the only true word of God and that every other version was somehow flawed. I grew up Catholic and did not have that experience because I was born shortly after a major transition in the Catholic Church. And during that time, there was a lot of uncertainty amongst Catholics about what they were supposed to do. The Catholic Church has been producing English translations of the Bible for over 400 years. But even so, for most of that time, laymen were discouraged from reading it. Just before I was born, all Catholic churches earthwide used the Latin translation of the original language books of the Bible when conducting their weekly rituals. Since very few Catholics could understand Latin, it was strongly believed by most that reading the Bible would be tantamount to rebellion, as if reading the Bible for themselves would be calling into question the church hierarchy's right to rule over their spirituality. Even after the churches began to conduct mass in the languages of the people and actually give their congregants permission to read the Bible, most members of the church were still not comfortable doing so. In my family, there are those that still feel that it is wrong for a layman to read the Bible. My first English translation of the Bible was the TEV, which is the designation of the Today's English Version. All English translations of the Bible are traditionally referred to by similar abbreviated designations. Another name for the TEV is the Good News Bible. I love the Good News Bible, but have to admit that it is very misleading. But that being said, it is still one of my favorites. For me, the Good News Bible makes the Bible narrative come alive, even if it does so in a rather inaccurate way. This statement might seem contradictory, but hopefully by the end of this video, you'll understand why I can make such a statement in good faith. As an adult, I became a member of the Jehovah's Witness faith and remained in that religion for about 10 to 15 years. I didn't just attend the meetings, but was fully dedicated to their teachings as much as anyone could be. That was my first experience with the belief that every English version of the Bible was flawed, with the exception of the version that was used by my religion. The designation of the Jehovah's Witness translation is NWT, which stands for New World Translation. I felt at the time that the New World Translation was the only version that stuck to the truth. Even after leaving that organization, it was a long time before I would read any other version of the Bible. The only other translations that I had ever read prior to reading the NWT were the TEV and the King James. The King James official designation is KJV, which stands for King James Version. The differences between these three versions of the Bible are quite profound, but at the time I was only aware of the differences that the NWT had correct and completely oblivious to the verses that the NWT had wrong. Not wanting to read a Bible that was obviously flawed, I stuck to the NWT for years. There have been many times when people have asked me which version of the Bible I recommend. And although I have never recommended any one particular version, I have always recommended lists of Bibles made up of ones that I liked, and those lists always included the New World Translation. I would still recommend it under certain conditions, although I will never read it again myself. The inaccuracies that exist in all Bibles cause me to have negative emotions, but due to my personal experiences with the Jehovah's Witnesses, I get much angrier reading a NWT than I do when reading a Bible such as the KJV. A perfect English translation of the Bible could never be produced by any man because there is never any perfect way to translate one language into another. But that doesn't mean that we can't accurately translate basic ideas. However, in order to accomplish such a thing, a translator would have to be humble enough to be willing to accurately translate the original language text into English. even if it went against their own pre-existing beliefs, which is not as easy as you might think. A Bible translator, by default, would be someone who is college educated with multiple high-sounding titles, which means that any humility that they may have had before becoming linguists is usually driven out of them by the system before they become Bible translators. University degrees have a way of removing a person's humility. In any case, colleges rarely hand out degrees to people who fail to achieve at least some level of arrogance. Unfortunately for us, no literal translation of the Bible has ever been produced. The time and material resources necessary to accomplish such a task and then to produce and distribute enough copies to fill the needs of every spiritually hungry English-speaking person on the planet would be far too great for any individual or group of individuals to afford. All translations of the Bible are produced by the churches with the backing of the current ruling world empire and the material support of our economic system's major corporations. This is how it's always been done. Such entities would never support the production or distribution of an accurate rendering of God's Word. Understanding this basic fact means that there is no hope of locating an accurate English translation of the Bible does not, at least in some way, support the policies of the ruling world empire, or which is free of church doctrine. But knowing that every version of the Bible is different means that it's only logical to conclude that some version must be better than others. With so many translations in circulation, the possibility that all of them would be equally good or equally bad would be very unlikely. But with all of the Bibles that are out there, figuring out which one is best would be very difficult, if not impossible. There is no one alive that could ever read every English Bible available and make notes about every questionable verse and then accurately rate them by comparing every version of every questionable verse. It would actually be easier to simply produce an accurate translation from scratch. But ever since people started to ask me my opinion on the subject, I have been making notes. Whenever I find a Bible verse that is translated in a way that is substantially different from the way that it appears in other versions of the Bible, I write it down. Using those notes, I think that I have finally figured out a reasonable way of rating a Bible's ability to communicate basic Bible truth to anyone seeking basic Bible truth. But instead of just making some kind of blanket statement about what Bible I think everyone should read, it might be more beneficial to explain some basic recognizable differences that exist. Because believe it or not, what Bible is best for one person might not be best for another person. Bible scholars have a way of classifying Bibles that actually makes some amount of sense, even though for the most part it's not very realistic. The two basic types of Bible are referred to as literal translations and non-literal translations. Non-literal translations are divided up into such subtypes as idiomatic translations, free translations, semantic translations, faithful translations, and adaptation translations. In general, to us mortals, the only two kinds of translations are really literal and what's known as paraphrased. And even then, there usually isn't much difference. I'll give you an example of the difference using the scriptures found at Leviticus and chapter 18 and verse 8. The King James version of this scripture goes like this. The nakedness of thy father's wife shalt thou not uncover. It is thy father's nakedness. According to Bible scholars, this is what's known as a literal translation. The New International Version of this verse goes like this. Do not have sexual relations with your father's wife. That would dishonor your father. The official designation of the New International Version is NIV. Since all translators understand that this ancient idiomatic phrase means do not have sexual intercourse with, it could be argued that the paraphrased translation is actually more literal than the literal translation. An unacceptable translation of this verse might go something like this. Do not remove the clothing from your father's wife. This version of the phrase might literally be more literal than the NIV translation, but would obviously be misleading, since the thought that it would be communicating would be nothing like the thought expressed in the original language. Another problem with this verse is its classification as literal or paraphrase is the fact that neither version communicates an accurate understanding of what is found in the original. In order to accurately translate the original thought being communicated in this verse, our scripture would have to sound more like this. Do not have sexual intercourse with the primary female sexual partners of your father. Neither the word wife or even the concept of a wife appear anywhere in this verse. In the ancient Hebrew scriptures, the word meaning wife is pilegish, which can only mean woman under contract or similarly, woman through a covenant. But the word used in this verse is Aish Shah, which means female leader of the male tribal leader. In most English Bibles, every time that the word Pilegish appears, it's translated as concubine. So now, if you've ever wondered what a concubine is, now you know. It's a wife. Other ways to accurately translate the word Aish Shah would be alpha female, female tribal leader, or free woman. While Bible scholars continue to argue over whether to translate Gela Erva as do not have sex or do not uncover the nakedness, none of them ever bother to bring up the confusion that's caused by mistranslating Aish Shah as wife. At this time, I have yet to find one single English translation of the Bible that properly translates either of these words. Understanding the difference between what this verse was trying to communicate in the original language and what it actually communicates in our modern English language should be sufficient to lead us to conclude that irregardless of how linguists classify a translation, that there is no denying that all English translations of the Bible can never be anything more than paraphrased. Most stories about marriage in the Bible are there to communicate to mankind the difference between the two kinds of relationships that humans can enter into with the Creator. In the book of Galatians, when Paul says that Sarah represented the Jerusalem above, also known as heavenly Jerusalem, and that Hagar represents the Jerusalem below, meaning the fleshly city of Jerusalem, he is actually comparing his natural relationship with humankind based on love with the unnatural relationship based on some kind of two-way official legal agreement that we today refer to as marriage. Many people find the book of Galatians to be confusing. But with just this one correction to our English translations of the Bible, Galatians becomes just as simple to read as any other book. It is a straightforward explanation from God about why natural law works, while religious law, economic law, and governmental law can never work. And the two words, Gela and Erva, put together are what are known as an idiomatic phrase. An idiomatic phrase that is very common in English would be passed away. In English, we would instantly understand that this is just another way to say that someone had died. In our culture, people use this phrase because they are uncomfortable with the concept of death. Even people who rarely use idiomatic phrases will say that someone has passed away in order to avoid saying that someone has died. But many people use idiomatic phrases all day long, usually in an attempt to appear hip or cool. In such instances, the idiomatic phrases are rarely beneficial at enhancing communication. If you look at the Bible overall, you will notice that the use of idiomatic phrases is relatively rare. In English, the average person will use many more idioms in their day-to-day communications than the Bible uses. In its original language, the Bible communicates its message with an extreme degree of accuracy. Perhaps that is why the number of idioms used in its narrative is so limited. But knowing that the original had such phrases means that there is nothing wrong with using them in our translation as well, especially if an idiom is used to translate another idiom, or if an idiom is used to more accurately translate a single word that has no English equivalent. Some Bibles, such as the TEV or KJV, seem to use more idioms than most, perhaps too many. Others, such as the NIV, seem to use less than most, perhaps too few. In general, the use of idioms shouldn't be an issue unless those idioms, or lack thereof, interfere with the accurate communication of the original thought. In other words, although many people feel that all paraphrased Bibles should be avoided, that is obviously and absolutely not the case. The only Bibles that should be avoided are those that do not clearly or accurately communicate the original thoughts of God that would have been recorded in the original ancient language text. My love of the Good News Bible is based on the fact that it sounds a whole lot like the way that I talk in real life. It may also be that way for you, and if you like it, you should use it. If you are better at understanding things from people that speak in a way that is similar to the way that you speak, then the Good News version may be better able to communicate God's thoughts to you more clearly, even if it doesn't communicate those thoughts as accurately. I am now going to tell you about a Bible version that you must avoid at all cost. Even if you find yourself on a desert island with nothing to read except for this version of the Bible, don't read it. Period. I always tell people that it doesn't matter what Bible you read, because all Bibles that exist are produced by the churches of the empire, and since that is the case, all contain church doctrines interspersed with the precious truth of the Bible. In most translations, the truth is so overwhelming that the doctrines can easily get lost. But the Message Bible, which is almost nothing but one idiomatic phrase after another, uses paraphrasing as a means of inserting church doctrine into nearly every verse of the Bible. The official designation of the Message Bible is MSG. Another way that Bibles can be classified is as modern English or as archaic English. The very first Bible that I ever read from cover to cover was the King James Bible, even though my first Bible was the TEV. I did not finish reading the TEV until after I had read the KJV. The KJV was produced during the transition of power between the British Empire and the American Empire during the reign of King George, who supposedly was an enemy of the United States. Many people mistakenly believe that the KJV was published by King James I during the transition of power between the Roman Empire and the British Empire, but that is not the case. The KJV that is available today is not at all like the 1611 King James Bible. The differences between the two are more profound than the difference that exists between our current King James and the New World Translation. At the time, theologians were beginning to recognize that many scriptures had been obviously and deliberately mistranslated in order to support unscriptural doctrines. Also, the English language had changed so much that by the time of King George, it was felt that the British Empire's version needed to be replaced. Both the King James Bible of King James, as well as the King James Bible of King George, are based on the Latin Bible of the Holy Roman Empire, which itself is based on the Septuagint of the Greek Empire. If you're a religionist, you probably feel the need to correct me, but I have read many Bibles in part or in whole and am not simply repeating something that I have heard. The Roman Catholic, Latin Bible, and every Bible authorized by the British Empire share many obviously mistranslated scriptures that harshly disagree with all original language text of the Bible. There can be no denying that the KJV was created as an English version of Emperor Constantine's Latin Vulgate. I never recommend any Bible that uses archaic language. Spiritual people do not need a storybook-sounding Bible in order to be inspired by it. More than anything else, we should want accuracy and clarity when being taught. Without clarity, there can be no accuracy. Even though I still occasionally use the King James when quoting familiar passages, I will never again attempt to read it. Nobody can truthfully say that it is easier to read Old English than it is to read the modern version of English, written accurately and clearly, using proper grammar. I don't regret reading the KJV. It is because of the KJV that I was able to learn the truth of God's Word, but I am a very smart man, and even for me, the KJV was difficult to understand. Even today, most of what I read in the KJV is confusing. Much of the language of that time is no longer in use, and as such, is no longer English. I won't go on and on about the strange wording of the KJV, but we'll give you one obvious example. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 25. The KJV says, whatsoever is sold in a shambles, that eat, asking no question for conscience sake. When I hear the word shambles, I think of an unkempt shack. But in King George's day, a shambles was a butcher shop. When I tell you that the KJV is a very poor translation for someone wanting to read the Bible for the first time, I am not saying so based on some kind of doctrinal agenda. I am basing this statement on the very reasonable assumption on my part that if I had read a modern language Bible first, I would have had a much greater understanding of God's Word much earlier in my life. If you ever see an internet article from an atheist about how wrong the Bible is, they will always quote directly from the KJV. Not because it is the most evil version of the Bible, but because they know that they can use the archaic language of the King James to confuse those who are spiritually weak with their atheistic reasonings. Today, there are several Bibles claiming to be the replacement of the KJV of King George. One of the earliest attempts was the ASV, or American Standard Version. Since then, many others have been produced. Some make it very clear that their publishers want them to be viewed as replacements for the King James by incorporating the King James name into the names of their Bibles, just as King George had done 200 years earlier. The modern King James, also known as the MKJV, the King James 2000, also known as the KJV 2000, the MKJV, or Modern King James Bible, and the NKJV, or New King James Version. It only makes sense that any modern translation be produced using the documents that are most closely related to the originals. There are literally thousands of pieces of ancient books of the Bible that have been discovered and preserved for Bible translators to access in their search for truth, clarity, and accuracy. The farther away from those documents a translator wanders, the less accurate their translation will become. Without a good unaltered text to translate from, it is not possible to produce an accurate rendering of the original thoughts that would be contained in those texts. However, it absolutely does not matter if a translator uses the best restored copies of the oldest extant documents, or if they use a document produced by Westcott and Hort, or if they use what is popularly known as the received text. Such a person is motivated to preserve the basic precepts of the KJV, then the only possible result could ever be, or never be, anything more than another version of the KJV. Since the Empire only supports the production of Bibles that adhere to the basics of its religion, every English version of the Bible produced can never be anything more than a translation of the King James Version of the 18th century, which is itself a translation of the King James of the 17th century, which is a translation of the Textus Receptus, which is a translation of the Latin Vulgate, which is a translation of the Septuagint, which is itself a translation of the original documents produced by the Bible writers. At each juncture, mistranslations of the previous version are preserved and new mistranslations find their way in. The very first translations cause the most damage to the text of the Bible. Both the Greek and Roman empires practiced some very disgusting things that God condemns, such as warfare, slavery, and lowered social status for women and foreigners. So these very first translations altered many verses in order to make it appear as if the Bible supports such things. Since the British Empire and the American Empire both have similar policies, all modern Bibles still contain those mistranslations. Other mistranslations involve unscriptural religious beliefs about such things as the nature of God, rituals, dietary laws, and requirements for salvation. The religion of the Greeks and Romans had many doctrines that made their way into the religion of Christendom, such as the Hellfire Doctrine and the Trinity Doctrine, and many scriptures were altered in order to support those false religious beliefs. A perfect Bible would not contain any of those things, but since no perfect translation exists or can exist, the best that we can hope for is a Bible that has as little of this stuff as possible. The less false doctrines that exist in a translation, the easier it is for such doctrines to get lost in the overall text. And with a basic understanding of what translators have incorporated into their versions of the Bible, it becomes quite easy to see through such things as we are reading our Bibles. People that are loyal to one Bible are usually part of a religion. All religions have an agenda. Looking back on my time as a Jehovah's Witness, I realize now that the agenda was physical labor and support of Satan's economy. Hence, every scripture that has ever been mistranslated to support slavery is perfectly preserved, and in many cases even altered to better highlight God's seeming love of a hierarchical system and hard physical labor. But since the Jehovah's Witnesses' faith is not a Trinitarian religion, all scriptures in support of the Trinity doctrine have been either removed or retranslated to be more in line with the monotheism of the original language documents. Most people who are Trinitarians hate the New World Translation, but love translations such as the KJV, which not only preserves all of the Trinitarian scriptures of the Roman Church, but even incorporates its own mistranslations in support of the Trinity doctrine. Most Jehovah's Witnesses refuse to read a KJV, while most Southern Baptists refuse to read an NWT. The reasoning in both cases is always said to be based on accuracy, but in my own personal experience, I have never heard such a claim from anyone that has any idea what is written in the original documents. In fact, most making such claims haven't even read the translation that they are supposedly loyal to. The actual reason that people stay loyal to one particular translation is always based on the understanding that the translation that they are loyal to best represents the manufactured doctrinal beliefs that they are most comfortable with. These two versions are very different from one another, and as such, I highly recommend that you read both if you're planning on reading a dozen different versions over the course of the next few years. But if your goal is simply to read the Bible all the way through once over the course of your lifetime, the version that you read should not be either one of these. If you're wondering about why I was so loyal to the Jehovah's Witness Bible for so many years, it has to do with the fact that it uncovered a truth to me that is still benefiting me today. Prior to associating myself with the Jehovah's Witnesses, I never once questioned the accuracy of the translation of any English Bible. I just never thought about it. But when I saw the word Jehovah used throughout the New World Translation, it caused me to wonder about why I had never seen this word before. I did not just simply accept that the Jehovah's Witnesses were right and that everybody else was wrong. When the Witnesses returned to visit me again, I simply asked them why they added Jehovah to their Bibles. The explanation that I got was shocking to me at the time. They said the Witnesses didn't add the name, but that the other Bibles removed it. He then asked me for my Good News Bible, and after quickly scanning the introduction, read right out of my own Bible that the translators had chosen to substitute the word Lord in place of Yahweh or Jehovah based on the fact that it was a church tradition dating all the way back to the Septuagint version of the Bible in ancient Greek. At Mark chapter 7 and verse 13, Jesus told the religious leaders of his day, "You make the word of God invalid by your traditions." It is an absolute documented fact that those religious leaders that Jesus was speaking to used the Septuagint version of the Bible exclusively, which, as the Good News Bible clearly states, is where their tradition of removing the divine name got its start. In nearly every Bible that I have ever seen, by tradition, the word Lord is always written with all capitals if the original word was Yahweh or Jehovah. But the word Adonai is also translated as Lord. The only difference being the use of lowercase letters. To me, this policy is confusing. When I am reading the Bible, it is irritating to have to stop every time that I read the word Lord in order to see if the word is written in capitals or lowercase letters. As an adult, I have learned that I cannot simply teach myself to recognize the difference as I am reading. Yahweh means to be, while Adonai is similar to our word sir. That is why in Spanish Bibles the word Adonai is usually translated as Señor. The two words that our English Bibles translate as Lord are not in any way related. The only reason that the religious leaders of Christendom are able to get away with following the traditions of the Pharisees is because while on earth, Jesus often quoted the Old Testament, and in every instance, he quoted the Greek Septuagint translation, which had the word Yahweh removed. On several occasions, Jesus quoted portions of the Old Testament that used the word Yahweh in the original languages, but he would always quote such scriptures as they appeared in the Septuagint version, saying Kyrios instead of Yahweh. Kyrios is an Attic Greek word that means Lord. There are all kinds of reasons that people give for why there isn't a single scripture in the entire Bible where Jesus used the word Jehovah or Yahweh. Many believe that all of the original New Testament books were rounded up by the Roman Church and destroyed. That just doesn't sound possible. With all of the time that has passed, it seems to me that someone somewhere would have stumbled upon at least one copy that had escaped discovery by whoever's job it was to round up all of them books. Plus, those that had the job of rounding up the Greek Bibles with the name and not rounding up the ones without the name would have had a very difficult time trying to figure out which was which, since the Latin alphabet was nothing like the Greek alphabet. It would be similar to an American policeman rounding up all Chinese books that contained God's name while at the same time not rounding up any Chinese books that did not contain God's name. At the time, all books, whether in scroll form or codex form, were handwritten with no page numbers, chapter numbers, or verse numbers, making the task of identifying an illegal dead language book even more problematic. When Jesus walked the earth, the common language of the people was Greek. Most of what is recorded in the New Testament is in Greek, with very little of the previous language of Aramaic used at all, and even less of the earlier version of Hebrew that Moses would have used. It is quite possible that nobody alive at that time was even aware that God had a name. I know that it shocked me to see the name Jehovah in the Jehovah's Witness Bible, and I imagine that it would have been the same way to someone living in the first century to see Yahweh in their Bibles or to hear it spoken by Jesus. There are three occasions that I am aware of where Jesus obviously quoted directly from verses of the Old Testament that included the word Yahweh. The first occasion took place when tempted by Satan. When Satan requested that Jesus do an act of worship to him, Jesus responded at Luke chapter 4 and verse 8 by telling Satan, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Satan would have instantly recognized that Jesus was quoting from a Bible that had removed God's name at this verse and substituted it with the word Lord. By using the Greek Septuagint version of this verse, Jesus would have been communicating to Satan that no matter how much the empire mistranslated the scriptures, the basic truth of God's word still remained. Also, it needs to be understood that Satan considered himself to be Lord. When Jesus said that he would not worship Satan, but only worship the Lord, it would have been as if he was telling Satan, "You are not the Lord that you think you are." In both other instances, Jesus was speaking directly to the religious leaders of the Jews. According to secular history, by the time Jesus came to the earth, those religious leaders had made it a capital offense to use God's name. Whether or not that is true, it is possible that Jesus was doing the same thing to those religious leaders that he had done to Satan earlier. In any case, whether he ever used the name or not on occasions that were not recorded in any of the books of the Bible, I prefer to read a Bible that includes the name, since it is now common knowledge that the earliest original language versions of the Bible used the name consistently. But having God's name in a Bible does not make for a perfect Bible. The only Bibles that I've ever seen that use the name always seem to have their own flaws, which in most cases are much worse than the flaw of removing God's personal name. The New World Translation consistently uses the name throughout the Old Testament, as it rightfully should, but it also uses it throughout the New Testament, where it obviously does not belong. Having a Bible translated in such a way makes it appear as if one of Jesus' primary teachings was to restore the use of God's personal name, detracting from his actual teachings as recorded in the original language books of the Bible, which we must conclude were more important. Many of the Bibles produced by the Messianic movement restore the name properly, including varying versions of what are considered to be restored pronunciations. The only problem with these versions of the Bible is that most are based on very flawed English translations, which are no longer protected by any copyright laws. What that means is that even though the names are probably more accurate than they would be in most English translations of the Bible, most of everything else is severely flawed. Plus, in most cases, such versions of the Bible don't just restore the pronunciation of God's name, but also restore the pronunciation of every other name, and sometimes even restore the pronunciation of words that are not even proper nouns. There are hundreds of very important characters spoken of in the Bible. I have spent my whole life reading the Bible, and yet I still get many of the characters confused. If you have ever accidentally referred to Noah as Moses or vice versa, just know that you're not alone. On occasion, I still do that as well. Imagine what it would be like to have to relearn these two very important men as Noach and Moshe. I have no desire to relearn the entire Bible list of who's who, just so that I can pronounce those names in a way that somebody theorizes to be correct. All of the original words used in the ancient text of the Bible belong to what are called dead languages. That means that there is literally no one alive who has ever heard them spoken. To take a bunch of written words and try to somehow forensically restore their pronunciation is not at all possible. These restoration Bibles, just like the Jehovah's Witness Bible, highlight teachings that are relatively unimportant while detracting from the actual life-saving teachings the Bible is trying to communicate. That being said, I do believe that any translation of the Bible should maintain consistency. In other words, every name in the Bible should be translated the same at each of its occurrences. A good example of a word that never seems to be translated consistently is Asher, who founded a nation named Asher. In our English Bibles, we are told about Asher, but when speaking of the nation that he founded, it is translated as Assyria. I don't have a problem with the Bible choosing either one of those names, but firmly believe that whichever transliteration is chosen should be used consistently, whether talking about the man or talking about the nation that he founded. The American Standard Bible was produced as a replacement for the King James Bible at the beginning of the 20th century. It restored God's name everywhere that it appeared in the original text without falsely restoring it to the New Testament. Unfortunately, the outrage of the churches over the restoration of God's name to the Bible doomed the ASV from the start, and they are now extremely difficult to locate. Another problem with the ASV is that it attempted to appease the churches by retaining the Old English dialect of the KJV. The replacement for the ASV is the NASB, which did just the opposite. The new version reverted back to the practice of removing God's name and replaced much of the Old English with modern English, but still retains the Old English whenever quoting God or Jesus. At least it appears as if that's how that works. Whenever I'm reading from the NASB, I still chuckle inside whenever I get to a verse where God starts speaking to the people and suddenly words such as thee and thy become part of the conversation. When I was about 12 years old, I was able to figure out on my own that God didn't speak Old English. Apparently, some people still have the inane belief that he does. At the time, learning that God had a name was a new and exciting thing to me. But as I grew spiritually, it was the knowledge that the different translations of our English Bible did not agree with one another that actually motivated me in my search for the truth. With scriptures like Revelation 22:19, which says, if anyone takes words away from the scroll or prophecy, God will take away from that person any share in the tree of life, I had always taken it for granted that no one would be brave enough to translate God's written word unless they were absolutely certain that they could do so accurately. It soon became very obvious that even though the insignificant differences could easily be the result of differing opinions, most major conflicts could not be explained by anything other than the fact that all of Christendom's churches intentionally mistranslate their versions of the Bible in order to support anti-scriptural religious doctrines. I am in a very unique situation. I have much more time to read than most people. Much of what I have learned about the truth comes from my ability to read multiple Bibles, as well as my ability to remember enough of each version to recognize conflicts when I see them. Most, if not all, of the mysteries of the Bible can be deciphered by the Bible itself. But if that Bible is not translated properly, many of those mysteries must remain mysteries. Most people who read the Bible are aware of the scriptures which speak of the mark of the beast, which is 666. And for whatever reason, these verses have become a regular point of debate amongst the religious conspiracy theory crowd. Most people believe that the key to understanding such verses comes from information outside of the Bible narrative. There are literally thousands of ways that someone can understand the meaning of what the mark of the beast is. But if we simply stick to the other verses in the Bible that are related to these verses, then all of the teachings produced from outside sources are quickly overthrown. In quite a few Bibles, we're told at 1 Kings chapter 10 and verse 14 that Solomon required a payment of 25 tons of gold every year. I would have read this verse several times without ever recognizing the significance. I know that in the ancient world, the ton would not have been a standard Hebrew unit of measure, but the chances of me stopping what I was doing in order to convert this into a Hebrew unit would have been about 0%. The first Bible that I ever read was King James, which records the amount as 600, 66 talents of gold. The second Bible that I read was the Good News, which records the amount as over 25 tons. I thought at the time that I had been somehow enlightened because in my mind I was unable to read about 600, 66 talents and understand what that was about. But I understood very well what 25 tons was. It wasn't until years later, when I was reading the New World Translation, that I saw the actual amount of the gold that Solomon demanded, which was 666 talents. But even then, I was in the dark about the significance of this number because according to the Jehovah's Witness religion, which I was a part of, the number 6 simply meant imperfection. And using it 3 times in a row was just highlighting that something was severely imperfect. It wasn't until many years later, after seeing the number as 666 in the New International Version, that I put 2 and 2 together and unraveled the meaning of the number 666. I did a video a while back called Written in Stone, Gold on the Plains of Dura. Anyone wishing to find out more about the connection between the 666 in Revelation and the 666 that Solomon demanded should watch that video on that subject. The abbreviation for the New International Version is NIV. In my mind, the only way to perfectly translate this verse into English would be this way. The weight of the gold that Solomon received yearly was 666 talents, and then in parentheses, which equals about 25 tons in our modern units of measure. Of course, religious people whose job it is to keep the world ignorant of truth would instantly accuse me of adding to the Word of God. Hopefully, you can understand that someone using a version such as the New Living Translation, or NLT, which is one of the versions that uses the English unit of measure, might never figure out the connection of the Mark of the Beast, but would get a clearer understanding of just how much gold Solomon demanded from year to year, since no one reading the Bible for the first time is likely to figure out that connection, no matter what version they're reading. An NLT might be a better version for them than the NIV. Although I have Bibles that I love very much, and Bibles that I hate, and Bibles that I'm pretty much indifferent to, I really don't want to tell you what's best for you. This video may be available online for the remainder of time that civilization has left before Yahweh sends his son to destroy civilization forever. My opinion may change many times before that happens. I don't see myself ever changing my opinion about the Message Remix version, and in fact there are several other versions that I hate almost as much as that one. But if time goes on and I read more and more versions of the Bible, my opinion in regards to which translations of the Bible are better or worse may change, maybe a little, and maybe a lot. I've decided the best way of listing Bibles according to accuracy and readability would be in the description box below this video. That way, as my opinion changes, the list can change as well, without having to completely redo this entire video. Just 2 weeks ago, I found the best Bible available and was very excited about telling everyone to run out and purchase one for themselves. A couple of days ago, the same thing happened again, only with a completely different version of the Bible. Something that I've discovered over the course of my life that may be very discouraging to you is that even after everything that I have said about the history of the Bible and the cost of producing Bibles, and the criteria that Bible scholars use when determining how to translate individual passages of the Bible, there are some very much more disturbing facts about how our Bibles are produced than all of that combined. Every modern version of the Bible that's produced today comes with an introduction speaking about the credentials of the different members of their translating committees and stating the reason why it was felt that it was time for a new translation, as well as the techniques that were used in determining the best way to translate individual scriptures. All of that is a lie. I have read several Bibles multiple times and even have read parts of many other Bibles. If what was written in the introductions of those Bibles was based on any kind of truth, every Bible would end up being identical or at least very similar to every other Bible. The only criteria that any Bible publishing firm cares about are marketing, copyright laws, and profit. There can be no other explanation for the incredible amount of conflict that exists in the different versions of the Bible. By law, any copyrighted book has to be unique to every other copyrighted book in order to get its own copyright. So even if a Bible was absolutely perfect, the only way to sell any other Bible under a unique copyright would be to produce a version of the Bible that was different, as defined by some very strict legal parameters. There is even a very clear percentage of difference that is required by law in order to obtain a copyright, and there isn't any way for any corporate entity to get away with an accurate translation unless it meets those set parameters. Every Bible publishing firm has an in-house legal staff ready to seize upon any opportunity to sue any rival Bible publishing firm if they think that they can prove that those criteria have not been met. The 100 or so Bible scholars that are supposedly employed in the production of those different versions of the Bible are not paid to seek out a more accurate way to translate the Bible into English, but to simply try to find alternate words that will allow the parent firm to file indisputable copyright claims. I have listened to several interviews of these so-called Bible scholars, and for the most part, every single word of every single interview exposes itself as a lie. None of our modern translations are any more or less accurate than any other because of this state-sponsored legalism. They are all, for the most part, just different. I said earlier in this video that if someone had a goal of only reading the Bible once in their entire life, my recommendation for that person would be different to them than it would be for someone wanting to read many different versions of the Bible. Reading several radically different versions of the Bible early on in my spiritual growth allowed me to quickly figure out a lot of what has been hidden from us. Often, in order to lend credibility to their own doctrinal beliefs, the churches will make a point of exposing the false doctrinal beliefs of other religions. So at least for the time being, I will try to post recommendations for anyone wanting to have several radically different versions to compare as well. Please don't go out and purchase every Bible that I recommend. It isn't necessary, especially if you work 70 hours a week for a company that doesn't allow you to read the Bible while you're working. As time goes on, I will hopefully be able to post more Bible videos similar to this one about specific things to look for. I could do an entire video just about scriptures that have been added to the Bible in order to support several unscriptural teachings that obviously don't belong there. I could also do a video just about syntax, which is the way that sentences are formed in order to make them come across in a more appealing way so as to keep our interest. I could even do a video just about things that are not even related to the translation itself, such as the physical weight of the Bible, the quality of the paper and cover material, and the size and readability of the fonts. I do not ever see myself recommending any one translation of the Bible over any other translation of the Bible. Even if I do one day discover a version of the Bible that I love more than all others, I know how people think. The last thing that I want to do is lead anyone to believe that any translation of the Bible is infallible. The Bibles that I love the most right now still in some way or another support non-scriptural doctrines, as well as such things as slavery, warfare, racism, and sexism. I hope that this video doesn't discourage anyone from simply picking up a Bible and reading it. I am well aware of the fact that my personal copy of the Bible isn't perfect, and yet I love it with all my heart. Jesus was well aware of the same thing in his day, and yet it is an indisputable fact that the Bible that was available to him The Bible that he quoted from every single time, the Greek Septuagint, was almost as poorly translated as those available to us today. And yet it is easy to tell that he loved that translation with all his heart, even to the point of willingly giving up his life in fulfillment of the words recorded in that translation of the Bible. Even if there are scriptures that aren't anything like the originals, the Bible overall still represents quite plainly how God feels about the things that are important. The Bible is not an instruction book for how to get to heaven, and to anyone reading it from cover to cover, it's more than obvious that this is the case. The Bible is about the war between God's kingdom and Satan's empire, the war between the righteous angels and the wicked angels, the war between creation and civilization. It is also about God's love for his Son, as well as his love for us, and the love of his Son for us. And even though many stories are about mankind's hatred of one another and disrespect for our Father's planet, there are also many stories about those that put love of God, love of one another, and respect for God's planet above all else. Let the churches twist God's word in support of their agendas. None of that matters. No matter what Satan's religions do, Satan will not come off victorious. The only people that would be misled by the verses that have been tampered with are religious people. Spiritual people would never practice nationalism, religion, warfare, racism, or sexism with or without a Bible. It doesn't take a Bible to prove that such things are wrong. Natural law cannot be trumped by legalism. The Bible is simply a written record given to man that God is aware of our situation and that he will soon rescue us. As terrible as our lives are under the domination of Satan's empire, we have to trust that the things that we are experiencing now will benefit us in the future. Fortunately, we don't have to wait hundreds of years to find out what God is going to do to fix this mess. All that we have to do is pick up a Bible and read. If you don't want to survive, don't listen to me.